First thing you shouldn't do is to dive in the pool. What we're gonna do is show you a quick and easy way to enter the pool so that you don't create any waves and compromise any spinal injuries. And you see, he's gonna ease himself down into the pool, not creating a lot of disturbance in the water, and now he'll be able to approach the victim from their head, and we'll go through with the procedure. Water temperature can have a lot to do with how long we have until we start CPR. If the water is 70 degrees or above, adults have a 30 minute, they can be under before we start CPR. Children can have an hour. If the water is 69 degrees or below, we're gonna give everybody an hour before we can start CPR. Again, if they're breathing, we can take our time. If they're not breathing, we wanna get CPR started as soon as possible so we get them out of the pool. We're not as worried about their spinal injuries. So our first victim here is gonna be a surface victim, somebody floating on the water in what we call the dead man's position, where they're gonna be face down and the arms are up. Brian's gonna approach this victim from the side. He's gonna grab under the arms. He's gonna start moving them and use his arms to help support his spine. He's gonna turn him over and he's gonna keep him moving slowly so that he doesn't sink and compromise the spine at all. He's gonna keep him moving so that he lays flat. So now what we're gonna show you is a shallow underwater grab. He's gonna be in the same position, but he's gonna be on the bottom of the pool in the shallow end. What Brian's gonna do is the same approach that we do on somebody on the surface. He's gonna approach from the side, grab his arms. The only difference is he's gonna bring him up at a shallow angle and not turn him until he actually surfaces. And this is gonna help protect the spine again, right into the same movement, and then they go right into packaging him. We're gonna do a deep water grab in the deep end of the pool, obviously. This will be somebody laying on the bottom, and we're gonna go over just how tough it can be to go get somebody from there. First off, we don't wanna dive off the side of the pool, as looking in the water can actually distort where somebody is and your dive may be off, or you can actually injure yourself and we cause a much bigger issue than what we have at hand. So we wanna enter the water like we would. You're gonna go under and then dive to get them, as you'll be able to locate them a little easier once you're underwater. The main thing we wanna get across here is don't waste a dive. If you're having trouble getting down to that person, obviously the most important thing for them to do is to get to the surface. And if you just have to grab their shorts, if you have to grab their hair, whatever you can grab to get them to the surface, don't waste your dive. Make sure you grab them and get them to the surface, and we'll take care of everything else from there. If we assume that there's a spinal injury, we wanna try to do the same grab where we're gonna grab the arms, and we're gonna, as we come up to the surface, we'll spin them to the surface. The only difference is now is we're gonna have to swim with this person and try to get them to the shallow end where we can do the packaging. We're gonna have to use multiple people. We're gonna have two of the other crew in there with the life preservers that we keep on the engine. We wrap them up and we can use them as help. As he comes up, we can put one of them under the victim's hips. That'll help him keep flat in the water, and it'll help the diver, the person that goes and grabs him, to get to the shallow end. The other guys here are gonna approach him from the side with the board. They're gonna shove the board underwater, make sure they get him centered, and they're gonna line him up. So they're underneath, and they're always gonna maintain that spinal control. So they've got him strapped down, they've adjusted, they've switched who's holding C-spine now. As you can see, Bobby here is against the wall. He's resting the board on his chest and using his hands to support the head. We're gonna strap him down, and the last thing we're gonna do is get his head taped down. Because obviously if he falls off the board, that's gonna cause a lot more issues. This is not a fast process. You need to take your time. Now what they're using is using a normal backboard, which will float. It'll help with keeping him out of the water. They're gonna use the head blocks, C-spine, just like we do, and they're gonna tape him. So they're gonna get him loaded up here, and then we're gonna show you how to get him out of the pool. Again, not a fast process. The quickest thing that you need to think about, let's make sure that he's breathing. If he's breathing, then we can take our time. They're going to remove him from the pool. So this time we're going to show you how to use a reef sleeve. They've already turned him over. Now they're going to approach him. We're going to use the reef sleeve just as a backboard. We're not going to actually put him all in the reefs. We're going to be able to lay him on there. We have head blocks already in place. We have straps already on there that we can use. It's a much more seamless transition of not having to put something together. And the reef sleeve seems to be a little bit more stable in the water when we use it. It has handles that we can use. Makes it a little easier for getting them out of the water also. So you can see they already have the straps pre-strapped on there. All I gotta do is go across, tighten him down. So again, the last thing we're gonna strap down is the head. The nice thing about the reef sleeve, we don't have to use tape. And obviously tape and water sometimes don't mix very well. There's a strap system set up on the reef sleeve already and works very well in the water. And you can see Brian also strapped his arms down. You wanna keep their arms nice and tight so they're not flopping around. They got him strapped in. Now they're gonna transfer to sliding him out of the pool. And there we go, we got him out of the pool. And he should be ready for transport. So now we're gonna move into our firefighter survival portion of this training class. Things to think about when you fall into water with your gear. Obviously that gear is not made for the water. The first thing you want to do is get the boots up out of the water. If your boots fill up with water, those are anchors for you. They're going to be pulling you down. The inner liner of your bunker gear, your moisture barrier, is going to be act as a flotation device by trapping air. And you'll have a few minutes there where you'll be able to float and possibly get yourself to the side to get out. All right, as you see, he came up and he's floating nice and easy right now. He's staying nice and relaxed. He's not moving a lot. The more movement you have, you're going to lose those air pockets and you're not going to be able to float as well. He's going to use his hands to use small strokes until he can hit the side where he's going to spin around and pull himself out of the water. Things to think about if you feel yourself falling, whether it's in a pool or inside, the most important thing to protect would be your air mask. Because when that gear gets saturated, your pants and coats, they'll increase their weight by 10 times. And so pulling yourself out is not a simple task. He's able to pull himself out of the water and get away from the edge. Segment, what we're going to show you is how you can, if you fall into a situation you may not be able to climb out, how we can doff the gear and get out of the gear that's going to take you under. So once Brad gets his gloves on here, he's going to fall in and we're going to go over the whole procedure. He grabbed his helmet and protected the mask as he entered. So as you can see, Brad's floating here. He's got his feet up out of the water to keep his boots from filling. He's going to take his helmet off and he can trap some air in there to help use that for flotation. Now notice he's not, a lot of movement is going on here. You want to remain as still as possible so that you don't lose that air that you trapped in the gear. It's going to help you float. We found that you'll be able to float for about 5 or 6 minutes before you really start kind of getting pulled under by the gear and the weight of the gear. So he's got a little bit of time to get out. He started with his gloves, got his helmet off. Now he's working on his air pack. One thing to remember also, is our mask, our Scott masks, are good to breathe underwater up to about 14 feet. That's when the pressure overcomes how much we can exhalate. It'll feel a little weird, the mask might pop on your face, and you're gonna have to kind of forcefully breathe out, but you can breathe underwater. Just remain calm if you do go under, and just keep slowly working and getting out of the gear so that you can get yourself out of this situation. All right, so right now he's got his air pack off. Now remember, we want to do the same thing as we would normally do if we have to remove our air pack. We got to go right side out first. That way our tubing is going to the left and we don't lose that. It doesn't pull it off of our face as we're doing this. So as you can see, as he gets his gear off, he sheds it away from him. He's getting it far away from him so it doesn't catch him and pull him under. One thing I want to point out is he's in gear that's made for this pool. So he doesn't have all his tools that we all carry in our pockets. And those are things that are going to weight us down and make it tougher. So he's working on the pants now. He's got the boots off, he's got the suspenders off, he's getting out of the pants now, and he's getting everything away from him. As you can hear, the mask is kind of popping a little bit because he's underwater. He's got all the gear off, he leaves his air pack on because he can use that air pack to float. Plus, you got your air mask on and you can still breathe underwater and then you can protect yourself until you can get help or get out. The last thing we're going to show you today is in the event that you fall into water, your mask dislodges from your face and fills with water, we're gonna show you how to purge that water out of you. So Brad's gonna go under, he's gonna fill his mask, he'll clip in, and he's gonna open his bypass. All right, go ahead, Brad. One of the things to think about is when this happens, you wanna blow out as you open the bypass, and it'll help clear enough water out of there you'll be able to breathe in your mask. As you can see, right there, he's purging the water. he'll be able to come up and he's able to breathe.